Hey, welcome. This is not about fitness. This is my shop cam. Yes, this is a rather weird time for me to be broadcasting. It is late at night. The reason I'm actually out here is because I'm getting my hand operated on tomorrow, and I really, really wanted to finish this up because I'm not going to be able to do much in the shop for a while after I get this chunk of wood taken out of my hand. So let me tell you what we're doing today and what I've been doing. A week ago, if you watch my shop cam broadcast, you know, I didn't have any fabric at all on the fuselage. If any of you have built model airplanes, this is actually somewhat similar to just covering a model airplane. If you've used monocoat, the heat shrink covering, kind of similar, except in this, instead of ironing on the fabric, it's glued on with a really nasty, toxic cement that requires a respirator. Let me quickly run you through the process before. Actually, let me tell you what we're going to do tonight. So I just put on this top piece. It's really loose, you see. We're going to heat shrink this top, which is really cool to do. But first we have to iron the edges, and I'll explain more about that later. But let me tell you what I've done on the fuselage. So I'm going to need to rotate it here so I can show you what came first. You can't see it all, but you can see most of it. So the first thing I did was I laid out the fabric for this bottom and glued it on the edge, glued it on the other edge, around the edges. Then you let that dry. Then you trim it so that it goes somewhere between 5/8 and 3/4 of the way around the tubing, because you need to wrap it around the tubing to glue it. You need to get as much contact with the metal as you can without it actually running around and touching the other side. You don't want it to do that. So I marked it carefully, then wrapped around the tube so it's glued all the way around the outside. You actually don't glue it to the stuff in the middle. You just glue it around the edges. And then I ironed everything. What the ironing does is it smooths out any bumps, but more importantly, it strengthens the bond between the metal fuselage and the fabric. So after the bottom was done, I heat shrank the bottom. You can tell it's very tight. So the bottom is done. Then I did the side. Again, I laid out the fabric, kind of clothes-pinned it in place to get it just right, and then glued just a thin tack line around the entire edge, and then again wrapped 5/8 to 3/4 of the way around the tube, marked it, and cut it off to wrap it around there. On the bottom, it was a little different because there's already fabric here. So there needs to be 1 inch of overlap. So I measured 1 inch and cut with pinking shears and then glued that bottom edge. Similarly on the other side, did the same thing. Now the top, the one thing you can see here that was pretty complex, this is a complex curve here. So this took a little maneuvering to get a nice tight seal. I'll show you that up close and personal later. But so what I'm going to do here, you're going to see building an airplane can be pretty about as exciting as knitting at points. This is one of those points where it just takes time and patience. So what I'm going to do, I need to iron these edges to smooth them out and secure the glue. I'm going to go ahead and get started. Now it's really important. It's really important that this be the right temperature. Anything over 225 degrees will release the glue, so you do not want to do that. So if you'll notice. So this is, the max temp was 208. Unfortunately, these irons fluctuate a lot in temperature because it's a thermostat. There's probably 40 degrees of hysteresis in this. So what I do, I want to make sure that the maximum temperature does not go over 225 degrees. So what I do, I wait, and you'll hear it click when it gets down to a low enough temperature. And I want to make sure when it turns on that it doesn't go above 225. So it's at 197 degrees now. It's probably about to turn on. Okay, it just turned on. I heard the click. Okay, it's 200, 210, 215, 221, 227. Okay, it's getting 232. Okay, that's too hot. 238. Yeah, that's that would not be good. So I need to turn it down a bit. Just a tad, that'll be fine. But you'll notice I'm going to keep this with me to monitor the temperature at all times. I'm going to start on the other side. By the way, I will be answering your questions. When I'm done, it'll take me about 20 minutes to iron these edges, and not long at all to do the heat shrink. That's the cool part. Okay. Just checking the temp. It takes a lot of time to get this just right. I'll check it again in a minute. Okay. So again, what this ironing does, it smooths out the bumps, any bumps in the glue, but more importantly, it gives a good hold. It helps the glue adhere to the, not only to the fabric, but to the tubing. For those of you who missed it, what happened to my hand? When I was working on these wonderful stands that allow the fuselage to rotate, when I was moving the lumber that I used to make that, I got a big spike of wood in my hand, and they couldn't remove it in the emergency room, and then it got infected, and the doctor says it has to come out because if I leave it in there, then anytime I move my hand, it'll cause internal bleeding and cause it to get infected all over again. So unfortunately, it's got to come out. It's not one, not all pain causes gain. This is a good finish job, takes patience. Already getting hot. No, I'm not stripping. It's hard to pull the trigger on this. It's still too warm. Gonna cool that off a bit more. So this is pretty exciting when this is the last fat. Well, I have a little more fabric covering to do, obviously. The vertical stabilizer there needs it. But this is pretty much the end of it. And then it's painting. After the painting, it's time to buy the engine. I'm putting that off as long as I can because not only is the engine the most expensive part of the airplane, but the warranty starts ticking the moment you take delivery, so you might as well wait until you're going to use it. Some of you may have heard of the doping process. That's a older aircraft use actually dope to finish. And the difference with dope, first of all, with dope you actually sand. So with this, when there's bumps, you use the iron to get them out. With dope, you actually have to sand to get the bumps out. And not only is this kind of finish more durable, but I'd much rather iron than sand. Sanding gets a, I'm just not a big fan of sanding in general, because it's no fun wearing a respirator when you're sanding. Okay, this is, I'm going to show you a close-up of this area because this was really tricky to do. These compound curves back here where the fuselage joins the vertical stabilizer. It actually turned out pretty well. Okay, so I have this side done. I'm going to work my way around to the other side there. Temperature check to make sure I'm on track here. Okay, I'm gonna start over here. I haven't done this yet. So if all goes well, see, it's probably going to take, well, I'm not sure what I'm trying to figure out how much time it's going to take me to finish. Well, this is not really something you can make a schedule for. The aircraft is done when there's no reason left for it not to fly. So, you know, you work on it till it's done. You can't hurry it. It doesn't know schedules. I've been working on this for 12 years now. And it is a very enjoyable thing to work on, but getting a little tired of having it clogging up the garage. So is the family. Come over here. You can't really see this yet, but this looks pretty bad because there's some excess glue here. After I iron and heat shrink, I'll get all that excess glue off. Certainly don't want to leave that on because it would make for a lumpy finish. And methyl ethyl ketone is the solvent that's used to take the glue off. Nasty stuff. Got to use full protection and a respirator. Again, the reason I'm doing this is sometimes the glue goes on a little lumpy, and this smooths everything out to give it a nice smooth job on the seams, but more importantly, it gives it a strong bond. The heat shrinking is really fun. I'm gonna bring the camera closer so you can see that. So this is actually not cotton. In the old days, they used really long fiber cotton, but I think not only did the cotton not last that long, but it's really hard to get the long fiber cotton like they used back then. I'm not even sure if it's available. So the synthetics came around, and this is, it actually shrinks with heat. And it's actually rather precise the way it works. When you put the fabric on, you'll notice like this, there's no wrinkles, but it's not tight either. And the reason you do that is to control the tension in the fabric. If the fabric's too loose, like if I flew it like this, this stuff would rip off. It can't be this floppy. It would flap like a flag in the wind and tear off within short order. On the other hand, you can't have it too tight, because if you shrink it too tight, it'll pull all the structural members in. And also, if you get it too hot, the fabric will degrade. So the way it works, you adjust the tension perfectly by adjusting the temperature that you shrink it. And I'll be shrinking it. I'll be shrinking to between 300 and 350 degrees. I'll set the iron. So the maximum temperature is 350 degrees. I do not want to go above that. But and the low temperature will be 300. As I say, you know, with those irons, it's really tough, because right before the filament turns on, it's like 300 degrees. And right when the heater turns off, it's 350. So, you know, it's not very precise. Only within about maybe 40 degrees, not 50. Nice. Almost done here and ready to heat shrink. Okay. I'm going to get you closer so you can see it, but first let me plug in my other iron. This is not nearly big enough to do the fabric. Shrinking. Plug everything, yep. You know, I never checked. I hope I'm actually broadcasting. Yeah. I'd really love to have use of my other hand. Okay, I'm going to see if I can get you closer so you can see what I'm doing here. Let's see. Hold on a sec. I think I can get you closer. Oh, sorry about that. Oh, this is the rocking cam. Whoa! Gee, I hope you don't get airsick easily. Okay, I'm amusing myself. Okay, let me check the temperature here. I don't know. Hopefully, you can't really see the... Can I get you closer? Hold on, I'll figure this out. Ooh. Will that work? Okay, let's try this. I'll give you the top view. No, sorry, that won't work. This will have to do. So I want 225 degrees. Let's see what this is. 250. Actually, 250 is good. As long as it's not much more than that. So I'm going to do two shrinkings. The first one is going to be at 250, and the next is going to be 300 with a max of 350. Okay, that's good. Now, if you you'll probably be able to hear this start creaking. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to go around the outside first. I want to shrink it evenly. So I did the edges, and I'm going to do them. You can tell it's already tightening up a little bit. Oh, not very much. I'm being careful not to gouge the fabric when I cross the structural members here. Okay, that's a good first pass. Do it again a little slower. Okay, let me show you what it looks like now. I can show you a little better.
So you can see here, there's still some wrinkles right there, but it's tighter. There aren't too many. This area is completely taut. There's wrinkles right there. You can see those. Big wrinkle right there. Look at that. That's going to come out, don't worry. And then this whole area down here is pretty wrinkly. So let's go ahead. I'm going to do it a little more evenly over these areas that are loose. Make sure I did those before I up the temperature. Yeah, I just didn't get it all the way. Now I need to be careful not to, remember I said the glue starts to release above 225 degrees. Well, this iron is above 225, so I'm making sure that I don't go near the edges, so I don't want to release the glue. Ah, this is beautiful. Have to use the small iron here to get this up there. Okay, now let's. That is much better. Actually, that pulled out. Actually, let me show you. Going over those areas that were wrinkled before. It's like it was wrinkled over here. Now it's reasonably taut now. Even this area here that had the indentation. The thing is, you can't tell by thumping how The thump test is not a good way of doing tension. It's all by temperature. It's temperature determines the tension in the fabric. Okay, let's see. Let's do this. See me. See what our maximum of 356. That's too hot. Definitely nothing above 350. I'm gonna let this cycle through a full heat cycle, and I want to see the low temp and the high temp. So it's 304 now. It's dropping 301. 295. I want it to kick on right about now. It's 289. Now is a good time to kick on. 275. I think I turned it down too much. Okay, it just turned on. So basically, 270 is the minimum temperature. Let's see what the maximum is. 328. Not quite warm enough. Maybe one more click. Let's go two clicks. I want it to kick on at about 290, 280. Still 280. Takes patience. Don't want to start ironing till the iron's the right temperature. 265, nope, still not warm enough. But I want to see what the max is again here. 328. 335. Okay. Give it another couple clicks. And do it again. Sorry, no, this is boring. But gotta be done. So, by the way, what you're looking at right here, this is the cargo area behind the seats. $285. Okay, come on, kick on. $267. 275. Good grief, why am I having so much trouble? It's not quite hot enough yet, but I'm going to start ironing. I know it's not too hot. That's the main thing. Just heard it. $342, perfect. That's where I want it. One final check. Gotta be temperature paranoid. So after I'm done shrinking here, I'm going to answer people's questions on YouTube. I think I have a rat. The first rat that's been in the garage. Ah, that's beautiful. This is a really tough curve here. This turned out really well. There'll be, I still have one thing that you haven't seen is I need to put finishing tapes on this. Anywhere where you see a member under there, in the wind that'll flap and it could abrade away. So what I need to do is put reinforcing tapes anywhere you see metal under here, and also on all the joints. So there'll be reinforcing tapes here on the edges. Not only does it make it look a lot better, but it provides extra abrasion resistance. Small iron here, too much really I need to stay away from. I'm going to show you in a sec. Very nice. Okay, let me show you what I've done, and then I'm going to answer some questions. Okay, so I'll give you an up-close view here. So remember how loose this was here? Tight as a drum. Beautiful. And this area, this is the compound curve back here. That turned out really nice. Again, there'll be a finishing tape here to hide this area. Very nice. Okay, I'm pretty much done for tonight. Go ahead and answer some questions. I'm not even sure anyone's watching, given it's the middle of the night for most of America. I guess I may have some people from... Where? Probably Asia and Australia, New Zealand, I'm guessing. Let's see. Let me go ahead and find my YouTube comments. Give me a sec. Oh, how about that? There's 120 of you who are up in the middle of the night watching me. Thank you for doing that. Chase Ames asks, Wo habe ich Deutsch gelernt? In die Hochschule und auch in Deutschland habe ich Deutsch gelernt. Ich habe 2 Jahre lang in München gearbeitet. Let's see. I was hoping for questions on the airplane. The Pyrrhagian Fingers asked, does something else go over the fabric? Yes. There's a pretty elaborate finishing process. So the first part is filling the weave with a brush-on product. It's basically like a plastic. And then spray on 2 more layers of that, and then 2 layers of aluminum oxide. That's to prevent the ultraviolet, because ultraviolet is what destroys the fabric. So there's 2 layers of aluminum, then you sand, and then on top of that goes the finished coat of paint. So it's a pretty elaborate process that goes on the fabric. To make it durable and light and protect the fabric against the sunlight. Thomas the Stallion asked a great question. Is it safe to fly your own plane? Well, I would say it's safer. I know I did put on every single thing on this airplane. I built it myself. I know it inside and out. I am confident that this is a safer aircraft than anything I could buy. So, you know, if I had thrown it together in a month, maybe I wouldn't be so confident. But, you know, I've been taking my time and doing it right. Let's see.
Sean Otta asks, where are the wings? Everything is in this garage. So those pink things in the back, those are the two wings. See them? They're hanging from the rack. Up there are the flaperons, the two long aluminum things. And then you can see the up hanging from the ceiling is the horizontal stabilizer and the elevator. Up there is the cowling for the engine. So everything's kind of all over. It's one of the biggest challenges in building a an airplane in the garage is making room for everything. It's kind of like one of those puzzles where you slide it around, there's only one open spot, and you have to arrange it in a certain order. Sometimes, I swear, it takes 8 hours to reconfigure the garage to work on a different part. I actually have, I don't know if you can see it here, but I have a pulley system so that I can pull the wings up to the ceiling and get them out of the way and then lower them down. And that's actually how I attach the wings to the fuselage, is I lower them on the pulleys till they're directly in position and then bolt them in. Romania, Sweden, Canada. Yeah, lots. Wait, what time is it in Romania? Oh, maybe you people are getting up early over there. Let me get some more comments here. Oh, okay. Bad Max asks, I'm new to your project and want to know the overall size and capacity. It's actually, let me show you here. It's actually two people. So you can see the two seats with dual controls. So it's actually two person. It actually has an incredible load carrying capacity. It's that's one of the reasons I like this design, because a lot of the planes are made for speed, and speed you need lightweight. And you know, if I were to sit in some airplanes, I could only take, you know, a quarter tank of gas because I'd be over the weight limit. But this one, the empty weight is 550 pounds, roughly, but it can weigh 1,550 on takeoff. So it's a 1,000 pounds of payload. You need of that, you know, me and my clothes and my bag is 250, passenger maybe the same. That leaves 500 for fuel and baggage, which is ample. Underground Fisters asks, Fishers, sorry about that. Underground Fishers asks, why am I building this? Because I love building things. I built model airplanes as a kid. I love woodworking. I'm an engineer. Perfect project. You gotta love building to build an airplane. You just do. Justin Hopkins asked, do you need a license? You don't need a license to build the airplane. You obviously do to fly. You need a private pilot's license to fly this. But you do not need a license to build an aircraft. But you do have to meet a lot of requirements, and it does get inspected by the FAA or a designated inspector. So you can't just, you know, put wings on your Volkswagen Bug and expect they're going to let you take off at your local airport. Good question. Where am I going to store the airplane after I'm done? Well, one really cool thing about this design, I'll show you at a later point. I can't really show it now, but the wings fold. I know that sounds really funny, but This has quick fold wings. You can pull out this pin right here, and the wings pivot back so they're back at the tail. And this actually fits on a standard, like 7.5 foot wide trailer. So theoretically, I could, you know, take this in a trailer out to the airport, fly, put it back in the trailer, and put it back in the front yard. But, you know, I probably won't do that. That's too much work. I'll just rent a hangar, or if that's too expensive, get a tie-down spot. But, you know, it's nice to have the option to put it in a trailer so easily. Let me get, 57 new questions. Okay, it's 11 o'clock. So I have 1 hour left to drink and eat. After that, I'm not supposed to eat or drink anything because of my hand surgery tomorrow. So that's the reason why I'm up so late. I'm going to have a good last meal and chug my water because I hate being thirsty and I hate being hungry. I'm not looking forward. That's the worst part of surgery, is not being able to eat and drink. Okay. Girls drink, it says, lawnmower engine, question mark? No. Engine reliability is really important. You know, back in the 70s, some people used like modified VW engines, but they just do not have the reliability you need in an airplane. You need a special purpose, tested, reliable aircraft engine. And I'm going to use a Rotax 912 in this. It's a great engine. It's actually water-cooled and not air-cooled, but, you know, they're extremely reliable. Let's see. Let's answer a few more questions here. Justin Hopkins asked, when will it be ready to fly? It's ready when it's ready. I'm hoping sometime this summer, but you know, I'm not gonna rush it. It's got to be perfect before it flies. There's no question. This is a good question from Ka to Ka. The fabric seems kind of flimsy. Won't it stretch or distort if you fly in cool or hot weather? First of all, to a lot of people, fabric seems old-fashioned. I should have mentioned this earlier. But it's actually an awesome design technique, speaking as an engineer. The reason is you can put the structural members where they need to be to carry the amount of load optimally. And you can design them to be anywhere within the structure. Whereas with a metal aircraft like a Cessna, you have to have that heavy metal skin, and they rely on that for the structure, and that's not always optimal. So what fabric allows you to do is design a perfectly optimal structure, and then just put a aerodynamic shell over it, a fabric. So it's actually more efficient weight-wise to design that way. And you know, the reason they don't design Cessnas like that is, as you saw here, doing this fabric is a really labor-intensive project. You can't automate it. And not only that, it's highly skilled. If you watched the rib lacing I was doing, you know, you can't have minimum wage people doing rib lacing. It's not going to work. So, you know, that's the reason they do all aluminum aircraft. It's a lot easier to automate, and so you don't need as much skilled labor. the drawbacks are that the fabric doesn't last as long as aluminum. No question there. With a good paint job, easily 15, 20 years it'll last. As far as the fabric being flimsy, no. It's very taut, as I showed you. When you shrink it to like 350, it's very taut. Not flimsy at all. Names Nicola asked, did I name the airplane? Not yet, but I don't think it's going to need a name. I have the paint job, and I think everyone will be amused, but it will be one of a kind, as you might expect from me. But I'll be painting it depends on my hand. When my hand gets better, within probably 3 weeks after that, I'll start painting. So you'll get to see what I'm going to do. Let's see. Let me answer a few more questions. Pro Aussie Biker asks, what's my engineering degree in? I'm actually an electrical engineer, but I'm doing computer science, and my real calling was mechanical engineering, but that's not my degree. But, you know, in my time off, I am not soldering chips together. Well, I used to do that, but I'd much rather spend it out in my shop. Good question from Dejan Cool. Why did you stop making the plane for a long time? Say my name too. I already did. You know, stuff happens. I started it in 2001 is when I started building this. I started, and then a number of things happened. You know, changed jobs. There were several huge house projects that had to happen, landscaping projects. Finally, when was it? Like three years ago, I got back into it hardcore, spending a lot of time. So, you know, it hasn't been full-time since 2001 building, but, you know, I still have thousands of hours in this. Although, you know, if you just added up the cost of the parts, this is a heck of a lot cheaper than anything you could buy. But if you figure, you know, even if I made 10 cents an hour, this plane is really expensive. But time is free, and it's, you know, it's a hobby. I'm doing it for fun. So it's not like I feel like I need to charge my time. Let me load some more questions. Got about four more minutes here. Hey, why aren't my questions loading? I'm going to have to reload the page here. Actually, this is a really good question. Underground Fishers asks, are you buying a parachute? That actually... He says, ha ha, no, it's actually a really good question, because there's a really cool technology. There is no room in this cockpit for a parachute. Well, I can't really sit in it right now, but let me show you. I am a big guy, and this is a small airplane. So even without any padding here at all, my head comes all the way up to the top there. There's no room above me. And my chest comes out you need the stick to go back to there. And, you know, my chest is right there. There's no room for a parachute on the chest between the front and the stick. It would keep the stick from moving. So there's just no room for a parachute in that cockpit. However, there's a real cool technology. It's a, believe it or not, it's a all it's a parachute for the whole aircraft, and it's a rocket-mounted parachute. And what it does, you know, you have a emergency handle in the cockpit, and if you pull it, it shoots a rocket up, and then the chute deploys from the rocket. So it actually works from even really low altitudes. Am I going to get one? I don't think so. Not, you know, I could, but it's tempting just because the technology is so darn cool. And these have saved a number of people's lives. I'm blanking on the name of the company, BRS, I think. But it's pretty darn cool. But no, I don't think I will. Good question from Jonathan. So I get at midnight is the last time I can eat. So what am I going to eat? Oh, I don't know. That sounds like a good time for a cheat meal. I'm going to chug a lot of water because water is what I like drinking. What am I going to have? I'm not even sure what's in the cupboards. It might just be boring and have beans like I normally do. Ross Davis asked, do I have a pilot's license? Yes, and I'm current. I have a private pilot. Sinad asks, how far can I travel? The plane's range is a lot further than mine. It can go, you know, 600-800 miles, but that's way further than I can go. I need to get up and stretch every couple hours and pee because I drink a lot of water. So the range of the plane is way longer than my personal bodily function range. So good question. Let me take one more and then we'll call it a night. Melcam 647, will you make the news when the plane is done? I hope not. That's not the kind of thing you want to make them. But what I'd love to do, I'm not sure if I can find a way to legally do this. I would love to have a live broadcast of the test flight. The problem is you're not allowed to have cellular devices when you're flying. So I'm not sure if there's any way I could do it live. Maybe if I work it in with the test instrumentation, I'd have to, I'd love to do that. I'm not sure if I can. Okie doke. I have to say thanks for joining me in the middle of the night. And wish me luck tomorrow. I'll talk to you. Probably be a couple days before I'm back online. So that's it for today. I'll talk to you later. Auf Wiedersehen.